morning and welcome to live streaming worship here at Emmanuel Episcopal Church. My name is Father David Bumstead, the rector here. Great to be with you over the internet on this Christ the King Sunday. If you're watching us online, which of course you are, you're joining your voice with several folks who have indeed joined us here in the nave. It's been a while since you've been back to church. We've missed you and look forward to your joining us again very soon. As always, don't forget to click or tap the like and share buttons below the video so that you can help us increase our online ministry. And a big thanks, we've actually seen a much bigger increase in sharing over the past couple weeks, which is a very good thing and helps us to get the word of God out to more people and of course give us more opportunity to share what we do here at Emmanuel. So excellent work out there, thank you. On Sundays we stream worship at 8 a.m., 10:15 a.m., 5 and 7 p.m. Okay, let's get started. Ken?
Thank you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Strong and shall no longer be ravaged, and I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, a servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them with and be their shepherd, and I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be the prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us sing together this portion of Psalm 95.
Come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout for joy to the Lord of our salvation.
Let us come before His presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to Him in His songs. For the Lord is a great God and a great King of all of us. In His hand are the powers of the earth and the heights of the hills of Christ also. Thus He is His form, He made it, and His hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and of the sheep of His hand.
Reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that God of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know Him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which He has called you. What are the riches of His glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is immeasurable greatness of His power for us who believe. According to the working of His great power, God put His power to work in Christ when He raised Him from the dead, seated Him at the right hand in the heavenly places far above all rule and authority and power and dominion. And
thank you.
sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." And the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, you gave me no food. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, you didn't welcome me. Naked, you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Thou art the King of glory, O Christ, thou art the everlasting Son of the Father. When thou tookest upon thee to deliver man, thou didst humble thyself to be born of a virgin. When thou hadst overcome the sharpness of death, thou didst open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Thou sittest at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. We believe that thou shalt come to be our judge. We therefore pray thee, help thy servants, whom thou hast redeemed with thy most precious blood. Make him to be numbered with thy saints in glory everlasting. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning at home. Every year about this time, I have the privilege of getting into the pulpit to proclaim to you that Jesus Christ is the King of the universe. That the first allegiance of every Christian is to his glory and the extension of his peaceable kingdom. This year, the year of our Lord, 2020, seems to me that this proclamation seems more relevant than ever. The world is held in the grip of a terrible pandemic. Our country is still lurching through an electoral process that is hampered, frankly, by an acute lack of charity across the American experience, regardless of ideology or party affiliation. A virus attacks our ability to breathe, our ability to be social creatures. Our social structures attack our ability to breathe as well, leaving us anxious and bewildered. There is a sense that in all that assails us, the human condition, American or otherwise, is more fraught and more tenuous than our thinking had previously been accustomed. So, I say that, and I realize that I sound like a massive pessimist. And I'll admit that there have been times over this past year where I've been a chalice, half-empty kind of guy. But the truth is, I believe with all of my heart the truth that this day's title indicates. Christ is the King. That's true this Sunday, and every other Sunday, and every day of every year, period. And because that's true, and despite the churning maelstrom of bull excrement we face these days, and need not despair, because the King of the universe knows me, loves me, and cares for me. And that's true of every single human being on the planet. That's true for you. And for the person you're fighting with on Facebook. You should quit that, by the way. Christ is King, after all. And we should not, why not act and type accordingly? Perhaps in the sermon. Which, all joking aside, really shows that even social media becomes a test case for the kind of kingdom, the kind of subjects God is calling us to be. Christ's kingship is predicated on his self-giving, on sacrifice, on the love poured out for us on the cross. And in, as Paul writes, in God's power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. If the body of subjects then might tend to take on the characteristics of the head, we should expect to become the types of people whose hearts are oriented towards welcoming the stranger, feeding the hungry, refreshing the thirsty, clothing the naked, caring for the sick and imprisoned, and so on. That's who we are. And since I believe that Christ is King, I also believe that his people are capable of such transformative behavior because the King himself transforms us each day to live it out. We've had to become more creative than ever in 2020 to live that out this year, haven't we? But the basics really do remain the same. Christ is King, so we say our prayers. Christ is King, so we love our neighbors. Christ is King, so we seek him out to know and understand him. Christ is King, so we love him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. This week, we'll all take one more day besides Sunday to give thanks. We'll offer the Eucharist here on Thursday morning at 10 as our own Thanksgiving feast. So even as we stay home or safely visit, whatever your plans are, this is the perfect time to reflect and to give thanks for Christ's kingship, to once again place our hearts at the feet of his rule, of his throne, just as the psalmist writes. Perhaps even this week our devotion might include one of the invitatory psalms of morning prayer, which part of which we said today in Psalm 95. The psalmist says, "Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, Christ is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his land." Such prayer might subdue our unruly, anxious hearts to the Lordship of Christ, allowing his loving presence to hallow our own, so that we can bring peace, love, and grace along with us wherever we go. Thus I pray that we are all filled with the power and humility of King Jesus as we seek his face, build his kingdom in this very needful world. To Christ, who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, a priest, serving his God and Father. To him be all glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. We believe in one God, the Father of the Lord, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
prayers of the people are Form 4, found on page 388. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant Almighty God that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty and gracious Father, we give thee thanks for the fruits of the earth in their season, and for the labors of those who harvest them. Make us, we beseech thee, faithful stewards of thy great bounty, for the provision of our necessities and the relief of all who are in need, to the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved you with the rest of ourselves. We have left you sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, and our mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness by the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Fortify and nourish. Since we had our chili cook-off last October, which in its way was a soft beginning to our stewardship season, I've been praying, searching for a way to articulate how we can approach this season, how we can approach stewardship this year. And to that end, and in a recent meeting with our leadership, we discerned together, guided by the Holy Ghost, I hope, three words that stood out to us: sustain, fortify, and nourish. So over the next few weeks, we'll be unpacking why those words are meaningful to us as we look towards this next year of ministry, 2021. But today, I wanted to start by just a quick reflection of the first one of that series, sustain. At first, and the senior and junior wardens will tell you, at first I was hesitant about that particular word, the term, sustain. My first pass, it lacked a sense of forward motion that I think is important in parish stewardship, but it seemed, frankly, kind of boring. But the more I thought about it, the more I listened to them, the more it became clear that there is nothing boring about how much God has sustained our ministry in the midst of the most difficult year, historically speaking, of my own life. God has indeed shown himself faithful in sustaining us in so many ways around you. Examples abound. There's too many to list, but here's a couple anyway. His safeguarding so far us from the absolute worst of the virus's terrible reach. In his graceful infusion of charity as we seek to love each other through these terribly divisive times. By his guidance over our parish leadership, as the wardens, the treasurer, and the vestry have kept a steady collective hand on the rudder. And of course, in his prompting of your generous giving, which have kept our ministry on the march, even during the strangest and most uncertain times during the lockdown. So like I said, in the coming weeks, you'll hear more stories about God's faithfulness on our ministry and beyond. And you'll hear more detail, of course, about our financial position going into 2021. You'll receive a letter from me with a pledge card, as you do every year. But today, I want to share a little bit about what God has used to sustain my own faith, even as I serve as priest and pastor here in Emmanuel. For me, it's funny to me because we're having such terrible internet issues today. For me, having the unflinching eye of the camera, the streaming platform, has led to a deeper appreciation of the discipline of daily prayer, of the daily office. And while learning how to live stream services was never super high on my list of professional or spiritual development goals, I know that it's been a lifeline for many inside Emmanuel's community, and indeed outside, as folks begin to share our liturgies. We get to minister to more people out there in the world. But even as a necessity, though I see it, I admit some discomfort with the platform, especially when it's not working. Despite that discomfort, having the opportunity to come into our beautiful parish to offer daily prayers, so many times for me riddled with anxiety, confusion, and even at times desperation, this has been a constant blessing, sustaining me for the long months of ministry in very strange times. The prayers help to steady my nerves, clear my mind, and open my heart to the fact that God's hope is alive in our ministry. It's alive here at Emmanuel. And really, hope is what I've hoped to communicate through all the mornings and evenings on Facebook Live, through all the weirdness of online prayers, the pandemic, and politics this year. That Jesus is Lord, despite our discomfort, his love and strength really does sustain us. As we look to celebrate Thanksgiving this year, I hope it'll take a couple of minutes from time to time this week to reflect and pray about how your own intercession, your ministry here, and yes, your giving, is part of how God seeks to heal the wounds of this world, and how he desires to sustain you, sustain us, and this parish for the year to come. Thank you for listening. In the coming weeks, you'll hear from our wardens, from our associate priests, and from other folks who are desperate to tell you their story. So please stay tuned to this spot. I guess that's more apropos for them. In any case, that's a TV show, guys. All right, I'm going to move this real quick. Excuse me. Very good. By way of announcement for you, happy Thanksgiving to come. It's coming on Thursday. Pray that you are safe and have a fun and relaxing time on that holiday. Do know that at 10 a.m. weather permitting, we'll be out front, out here on the front steps of the church for our Thanksgiving Day service. And we'll have some chairs out and folks can keep their distance from each other and all that. But we will have service once again at 10 a.m. on Thanksgiving Day, right out front of the church, weather permitting. Does anybody know what begins next week?
Advent.
Isn't that weird? Yeah, I think it's weird. Pop quiz time. You can play along at home. What color does this parish use for Advent?
Blue.
Nice. Go to gold star now. Very good. Does anybody... Does anybody remember any of the church changes that we make? What's that?
Advent
wreath. Right. We've got Advent wreath coming. Good. Yep. We changed the croppers. That's from the reader. Good job, buddy. You go to your B. Yeah, I'm so impressed. Oh, we're paying attention. This is great. So we'll go to a different theme, really, in Advent. You go from the joy of the season after Pentecost, or whatever it is, to a more introspective season of penitence and expectation, as we wait the coming of our Lord in Christmas. We'll also see a couple of things at the end. Of course, the order of the service changes a little bit at the beginning, and as we have been doing over these past few years, we'll incorporate what's called the prayer of humble access back into the community liturgy. It's a great way for us to dial down just before we receive and ask God for his forgiveness over our lives. So, I'm excited about Advent. I love the music. It's actually my favorite season. Fall formation continues, by the way, Tuesday evening at 6:30. I think we're finishing up Titus.
This week's the last week.
Very good. We're finishing up Titus this coming week, on Tuesday at 6:30 via Zoom. If you'd like the Zoom link, contact us at the front office or contact Lisa and Tom. Thursday evenings, we've been reading the Gospel according to Luke. Thursday being a holiday, we'll take a break this week. We'll start back up again next week. If you would like a link to those Zoom meetings, just contact us and we'll get those right to you. They are available via the church constant contact emails. Very good. If you are celebrating the anniversary of your birth this day or this week, let's pray. Oh God, our time's in your hand. With favor, we pray for your servants at the beginning of the year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their life. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're celebrating the anniversary of your wedding this day, or this year, or this week. Let's pray. Grant, O God, your compassion that having taken each other in marriage and affirming again the covenant which they have made, they may grow in forgiveness, loyalty, and love. Come at last to the eternal joys that you have promised in Christ our Lord. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
Yeah.
captives and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he gave thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command of Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming, Lord.
We offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the covenant. Unite us to your Son in the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable to him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power of the glory, forever and ever.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you.